Good morning. My name is Jalen, and I'm a senior at McDonald 35.
And I'm Shadee Stewart, also a senior here at McDonald 35 High School.
We will serve as the MCs for the next 90 minutes. First, I would like to thank the Lowell Nine Walls Voters Coalition and the Orleans Parish School Board for organizing and supporting this historic event. I want to thank the Executive Director, Mr. Harold Clay, for permitting us to hold our forum at McDonald 35 High School. I also want to welcome you, our audience, to our student led candidate forum. I want to sincerely thank the candidates that appear before you today for agreeing to participate. This forum has allowed us, the youth, to participate in a democratic process around civic engagement. As millennials, we're concerned with many issues, the qualifications and platforms of the candidates who seek to hold office and represent the citizens of this city.
It is important for the candidates to hear the voices and concerns of high school students, as presented by representatives from the following four schools. John F. Kennedy, McDonald 35, St. Augustine, and Washington Public School, members of the Orleans Parish School Board, the mayor and her staff, and other invited guests for your attendance at this important event.
This event has given us the opportunity to work within our school and with students from other schools to present our unique concerns, having a good relationship between our elected officials and youth across Orleans Parish is important. Developing a good relationship begins with good communication. We're excited to present our questions and have our voices heard here today. We look forward to hearing the candidates' responses. As we begin our program, we will have a welcome by Mr. Harold Clay, Executive Director of McDonald 35 High School.
Opportunity to welcome you to McDonald 35, where our scholars are the best and the brightest. I really want to start off by saying thank you. Thank you for your active engagement. Thank you for taking responsibility for holding our elected officials, or soon to be elected officials, responsible. But thank you for proving all the naysayers and naysayers wrong. I'm telling you today, I'm standing before you today that it's no doubt in my mind that you are the change agents. Because of you and your civic engagement, you will be the change agent that this city needs so, so desperately. So this morning I welcome you, and I can't wait to get started. Thank you.
The school level committee selected one student to represent their school and have that student ask their question. The questions that are being asked today are a result of a collaborative effort of all the core member team and student representatives. So as you answer the questions, please know that these questions are being asked because the issue is important to many students in our school.
Please allow me to introduce the five candidates who are vying to be one of the two United States House of Representatives for District 1 and District 2. Leanne Glass. Jim Francis, Jesse Smith, Tammy Savard, and Chandra Rodriguez. You all may get on the stand now. Now I will lay out the rules of engagement. As an audience member, we invite you to listen to the questions and the responses given. While clapping is allowed to show your agreement, at no time should any member of the audience boo the questions from students or response to the candidates. Also, limit your walking and refrain from side conversations so that everyone can see, hear, and become informed. Candidates, please know our timekeeper. You have 30 seconds for your opening statement, closing statement, and 90 seconds for your responses to each school's question. The timekeeper will give you a 1 minute warning, a 30 second warning, and then stop.
Testing. Okay, good morning, everybody. My name is Tammy Savoy, and I am running to serve as our next congresswoman from Louisiana's 1st Congressional District. I am a retired Air Force Lieutenant Colonel. I am a licensed clinical psychologist, and I am a mom. I have a 26-year-old daughter who is a successful lawyer now working in New York City. And I just want to say to y'all that your education is
so important.
And with that education, you can do anything you want to do.
So I want to tell you
that I'm here to talk about your education,
your safety,
and your dreams. I want to hear from you what's important today, and that's why I'm here to talk to you all. And I'm very honored to be here with you all today. Thank you so much.
Good morning, students. It's so good to look out and see you all. And I'm actually a former student of McDonough 35. Go around. Yeah. Of course, we were in another building, 1331 Kellerag, and this brings so much memories as I walk these halls, although not the same halls, and look upon your faces and see the hope. And the questions and the desires that are in your hearts, it exudes through your faces. That's it. That's fine. Just two more seconds. I am running for the 2nd Congressional District of Louisiana. You guys are very important to me. Your education is highly important to me. And I hope that that is made evident to you guys today. Thank you so much.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Jesse Schmidt. I'm also running in the 2nd Congressional District. I, when I was Jell's age, actually was going into the Navy. I didn't have the opportunities to go to college and things like that. To be honest, I was kind of a C student, so I didn't get scholarships. But that being said, it's important where you guys are nowadays. I mean, you know, you literally can be anything. I know everybody says that and it's a cliche, but I tell you what, a lot of my peers would never have guessed in a million years I'd be standing up here right now as a candidate for Congress talking to you guys. But you know what? This is America, and everything can, you know, anything can happen. So with that, I think I'm out of time. I see it. Sorry, the light kind of gets us here. Thank you.
I have 90 seconds for your responses. Our first school question comes from St. Louis. Our first question will come from Clarence Sterling, representing St. Louis. The candidates on our responses will begin with Jesse Smith, followed by Tammy Savoy, then Sandra Rodriguez.
Good morning, my name is Clarence Dale, and I'm a senior at St. Augustine High School. The question is, what would you do to support diversity on Capitol Hill? What would you do to support diversity on Capitol Hill?
Just so I understood, and thank you for the question, you're asking what I would do to support diversity on Capitol Hill. Well, I mean, to me, I'm a moderate, and so when I look at things like racism, sexism, things like that, to me it's a barbaric, outdated view that has been illegal for years. I mean, go on forever. But it's still being practiced, and to me it's disgusting. To me these things are about as important as eye color or hair color or anything like that. It's like, why are we constantly trying to divide ourselves instead of uniting ourselves? And that's really the core of why I'm running. Is because when I turn on the news and I sit there and I see everybody that got the talking heads from one side and the talking heads from another just constantly pitting us against each other, finding anything that's different about us and trying to focus on that instead of what unites us, it sickens me. And that's why I'm here. I got fed up. I got fed up of sitting there and just watching and just like letting people just get their ratings and everything else based off of, okay, I'm different because, you know, I come from this group, or I'm different because I come from this group, or whatever. It's like, wait a minute, aren't we all Americans here? You know, isn't that what government's supposed to be about? It's supposed to be about a nation that lives together under common laws. It's not supposed to be about groups of people getting their own agendas. push through, and that isolates a majority of other people. That's not what this country's about. It's never been what this country's about. You've made mistakes in the past, but you know what? It's 2018. It's time to come together as a country as one for once. Thank you.
Okay, so y'all, diversity to me is extremely important. For one thing, we come, you know, our nation is full of so many different types of people, all different ethnic backgrounds, cultural backgrounds. What we need is different points of view. So the idea that we have diversity is a very good idea. It really helps us get all the best ideas, bring them together from everybody's different perspective, life experiences, and different viewpoints. So it's very important that we have diversity in Washington, D.C. So we have a staff that we would be able to hire. The most important thing for me to do when I get to be your congresswoman is to make sure that I have diversity represented on my staff so that I can hear everyone's voice and I can understand everyone's perspective and take that into account. And then when we pass our legislation, we make sure that our legislation does not have discriminatory or effects that are, you know, seven order effects that we weren't really aware of that impact people in a negative way. So the idea that we need diversity is a good idea, and we must, as our nation is so diverse, we must have diversity in Washington, D.C. We must have diversity in our congresspeople, and we must have diversity in on our staffs. And that's what I will do, and I will also look at all the diverse ideas out there and make sure they're all represented. So important. Thank you all very much.
May I ask you the question when you use the word diverse? Diverse in what specific way when you pose that question? Diversity in what? A diverse in parties, race, what do you mean?
Everything you just said.
Everything, okay. So diversity on Capitol Hill is really important. I do believe that we have that it exists. When we speak of diversity on Capitol Hill, this is where our congressional laws are made and enforced, Senate laws and rules changed, amended, so on and so forth. So diversity to me, when you ask that question, it's just like Tammy said, it's just diverse points of views. I am a constitutionalist. When it comes to this seat, the congressional seat, we come together, diverse backgrounds, we different parties, but it is for the good of the people. So in our role in Congress, diversity comes from parties, it comes from race, and all of that is represented already. What I would bring to Congress is the support of our Constitution as it is. The support of education that will not be dominated by our government. It will be done here at a state level. So diversification exists. I look to only enhance it and uphold the freedoms in which we were all given by the Constitution of these United States to be able to choose and continue to have diversification in Capitol Hill and on a state level. So I believe that diversification is well represented in the Congress. I am a conservative myself. As I mentioned, I'm a constitutionalist. I am not identified with Republic, but I do represent we the people.
Hi. The country is really divided. Many people feel President Trump is dangerous, and some feel he is safe. If elected, how would you work to support and oppose policies?
Well, that's the whole platform, and the thing keeps going out. So I'll just talk loud. That's the whole point of my platform. You know, right now, it's like I said in my opening statement, everybody's divided. It's left, right, conservative, liberal, and everybody's fighting and everybody's talking about that. But where's the common sense coming? Where does it go, hey, look, okay, you have this view, you have this view, and our views cross right here. Why can't we just concentrate on that? Why can't we concentrate on where they overlap instead of always constantly fighting left and right, and, you know, Democrat, Republican, and then nothing gets done. I mean, how many of you turn on the TV every day, and that's all you see is, oh, the Democrats did this, oh, the Republicans did this, and nothing's getting done. All they're doing is complaining about stuff. That's why I'm running. I'm tired of it. I'm an independent because I don't identify with either party. I identify with the American people. And I think that there's a lot of people out there that think that. And a lot of people that are sitting at home, and that's why we have such low voter turnouts, because all we got to do is to go against stinkier, stinkier. And that's it. We don't have anybody in between. You know? And I'm sorry, I wasn't pointing at these two. So please do not take it that way. But no, what I mean by is that, you know, we have these two parties that are constantly at battling, and that's why we have such a low voter turnout. And please, when y'all get into that voter booth, do what you're doing now. Listen to your candidates. Find out what you want and vote for it, because it's really important. If the last presidential election didn't tell you that, I don't know what did.
Okay, so I'm going to disagree with that a little bit. I don't think there's a left and a right. I think there's a right and a wrong. So what we really have to do, when we have a president that implements policies that are morally wrong, unethically sound, we must challenge that president. So we are separating parents and children at our southern border and putting children in cages. We are challenging that president. That's not a Democratic thing or a Republican thing. That is a moral thing. That is an ethical thing. And we must challenge the president on that, whether you are Republican, Democrat, or independent. Right or moral, if I can find that event, I will support him. I have not found that event as of yet. Okay, so when I get to Congress, my goal will be to make sure, now you all have had civics, right? And you know that the legislative branch, one of their responsibilities is to hold the executive branch, the president, in check. And this legislative branch that we have now has not done that. And I will go to Congress and I will make sure the legislative branch fulfills its responsibility to hold the executive in check. We have checks and balances, and that's what I intend to bring to Congress. Thank you.
Well, that's pretty hard to follow. I disagree with both opinions, actually. Our president was elected to get a job done. We have to realize that when we go to vote, we need to look at the issues. We do not vote in a pastor or a priest into our office. We vote for someone who can lead our country, lead our nation, protect us, and protect our families. This president has done more in 2 years than the last 8 administrations have done in terms, hear me out, you must hear. This president does not support the murder of unborn babies in the womb. This president promotes protecting our nation, keeping our nation, our children and our families from harm. This president has allocated over $200 million because he cares about each and every one of you. He has stated a key priority of his administration is to better equip America's young people. This president does not, and I do not agree with murdering unborn babies in the womb. I do not agree with illegal immigration. This president has taken care of every illegal immigrant that has come into this state, this nation. Every picture that you see of the cages is from the prior administration. I urge you guys to do research. Think independently. Make informed choices and decisions. Thank you.
I'm a junior at John F. Kennedy. Hopefully my next question will cool the pot. What are some ideas to engage the youth in politics, local or otherwise?
Really good question. Well, first off, That's why I'm here. I actually have I have two 17-year-old children, and they think politics is boring. And they're like, why are you doing this? And I said, why do you think it's boring? And they're like, well, because all they do is complain about stuff. And I was like, well, why do I sit around and complain about stuff? They said, yeah. And I said, well, what am I doing about it? And they said, well, you're running. And I was like, so what, are you going to go complain louder on TV? And I said, no. I said, I'm going to go do something about it. You know, I was like, you know, and that's what I would encourage the youth to do. You know, right now we're talking about voting. Obviously, none of you guys can run right at this moment because, it's closed. But anyway, maybe in 2 years, go for it. Run for this seat, please. I would love to see, you can't. You're not 25 yet. You see that? But anyway, what I'm trying to say is that it is important. It's extremely important to get involved. And when I got the invitation to come here, I jumped on it. I'm supposed to go speak at my daughter's civics class as well. And I know it's boring. I know it seems boring. I mean, you're probably sitting up here like, okay, yeah, we got out of class, you know, so we can go talk, hear these guys talk. But, you know, it's not. You know, the things that are being done today, you know, especially with, like, say, for instance, environmental policies and things like that, they're going to affect you guys. They're going to affect not only you guys, but it's going to affect your children, your grandchildren. You know, and all stuff goes, I'm sorry, I'm getting a red flag. Sorry, it took me a little off guard there, but it was a great question.
That is a great question, and I am so happy to be here today, and this is so much fun. I think that engagements like this across our great state, across our great nation, is what we need. We need more civic engagement, more civics classes. Now, I was in the military from the time I was 18 until the time I was 56, okay? That's a long time. And I had a lot of young people, either when I was young or when I was older, young people working with me and under me. And the civic engagement that they got engaged with was so important. So whether it is cleaning up the streets, or going painting an old dilapidated building and refurbishing it. Civic engagement is so important, as is volunteerism. So what I would like and ask for all of you to do is to contribute to your community in any way that you can find, whether that is through a church organization, a volunteer organization, your school, anything, but you can make a difference. You are our future. We need you. We need you to become civically engaged. We need you to get and make a commitment to your education, make a commitment to your community, make a commitment to your state, and make a commitment to the United States of America, because this is the country that you will inherit, and we need you to make it the best country that we can be. You are our future. Thank you. Get involved.
I do, but that's a great question. Our political system, our government, is the backbone for our country and our nation. It is what allows you guys our freedoms, everything. You guys are our future. When I look out at you guys and I see, you know, just the hope that is there, I would encourage you guys to be independent thinkers. Do your research on everything. Do not allow someone to tell you you should do this or you should do that. Do your research. Look at the left, look at the right, and look at the in-between. You guys are a generation that is empowered with technology. I would urge you to use it. Make sure that you look at everything and every angle before you make decisions. It has been said that the most dangerous citizen is not one that is armed with a weapon, but it is one who is uninformed. I look out at you guys and know that you are our future. I will fight at every juncture to make sure that your freedoms are protected, your rights are protected, and that you are able to continue to be independent thinkers, not indoctrinated with one way or the other, but able to be given information and to choose. I am running this campaign to protect rights and promote values. I intend on being an influence in Washington. I'm gonna stand firm against the extreme left agenda and the promotion of socialism. I will promote capitalism at every juncture. I intend on voting and introducing measures that will defund Planned Parenthood and the murder of 60 million unborn babies. I am running to promote capitalism. I intend on being, I am your conservative choice in this race.
Y'all, thank you so much for allowing me to be here today. So please find out more about me. I'm at TammySavoy.com, and I have my platform up there, and you can find out everything that I believe in. I believe in fighting for Louisiana. I am a capitalist, but I am a democratic capitalist. I believe in a moral and ethical government, and that's what we need, and that's what we can have. We can have both. We do not have to have an unethical government just to have a capitalistic government. We can be moral. Thank you so much. Go out. Vote.
In this particular race in the 2nd district, congressional district, we have it all. We have the right, we have the left, and then we got me in the middle. And, you know, that's what I'm here for. I felt like there was a silent majority that was the middle. It's a 2-year term. You guys give me the opportunity. I will do everything I can. I won't be here forever. If I am elected, I've always said I'd do 3 terms. I'm getting out. I'm not a politician, obviously. I don't have the charisma, I guess, that a lot of them do, but I'm pretty smart. I want to represent.
The Louisiana legislation proposes to add Article 1, Section 10.1 to the Louisiana Constitution. Do you support an amendment to prohibit a convicted felon from seeking or holding a public office or appointment within 5 years of completion of a sentence unless he's barred? Proposed Amendment Number 2. Act 722 of the 2018 regular session of the Louisiana Legislature. Proposal to amend Article 1, Section 17A of the Louisiana Constitution. Do you support an amendment to require an unanimous jury verdict to all non-capital felony offenses, cases for offenses that are committed on or after January 1st, 2019? Please allow me to introduce the candidate who is vying to fill the office of Clerk of Court, Civil District Court, Chelsea Napoleon.
Good morning, everyone.
My name is Chelsea Richard Napoleon, and I am your clerk of Civil District Court for Orleans Parish, and I'm running for election in November, asking to continue to serve as your clerk of Civil District Court. My story is that I've served in the clerk's office for over 16 years, I was chief deputy for over 11, and now I am your clerk of Civil District Court. So I'm asking for your help and support with those efforts. You can help by telling people about me. You can help by volunteering on the weekends or after school. Anything that you would like to do would be appreciated.
And I'm a senior at St. Augustine High School. Our question is, what skills or qualities are most important in a clerk?
Is one, to be dedicated to the clerk's office, to understand what we do and recognize that your skill set lies there or does not. So for example, having served in the clerk's office for over 16 years, we are responsible for the legal processing of your civil lawsuits, as well as all of your property records for Orleans Parish. So it's important that the person who is your clerk be a lawyer, so that they can understand the legal processing of those documents. Everything that we do is embedded in the law, both our public-facing functions and our internal operations. I am a lawyer. Additionally, I am your clerk of Civil District Court. There is no one better to serve as the clerk than the clerk. I have dedicated myself to serving you for the majority of my career, having worked at the clerk's office since 2016 straight. I graduated from Benjamin Franklin for high school. I received my bachelor's degree and my master's degree from the University of New Orleans. I received my law degree from Loyola, where I attended at night, worked at the clerk's office during the day, and raised my daughter. So I have uniquely prepared myself to ask to continue to serve as your clerk of Civil District Court.
So, you spoke a lot earlier about what you do in office. Could you go into depth about explaining the functions of your office and how you go about your
Anytime someone files a lawsuit, be it a succession matter when someone passes away, or an accident, a car accident, or some other accident, an oil spill kind of accident, any range, be it a domestic matter, divorce, child custody, child are filed within the civil division of my office. So we handle a myriad of matters across the spectrum. Then with our property records, we are the official public record for all of land records for all these matters. So anytime ownership interest is changed in the house, be it through a sale, donation, or otherwise, those documents are recorded in my office. Anytime someone takes out a mortgage, any kind of grass lien, or other encumbrance, those documents are recorded in my office. So day to day, those are the kinds of duties and functions that we perform in the clerk's office. In my 30 seconds, I want to tell you that you are important. In my 30 seconds, I want to tell you that I am asking to continue to serve you. In my 30 seconds, I want you to understand that although you don't have a lawsuit today or a domestic matter or property, eventually you will, and you want to know that your records are held and maintained properly, and I can continue to do that. In my 30 seconds, I want to ask you for your support through, again, talking me up, telling your friends and your parents. My name is Chelsea Richard Napoleon, your clerk of Civil District Court, and I am number 53 on your ballot.
All right, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
My name is Timothy David Gray. I'm serving as your clerk of First City Court. I grew up right here in New Orleans. I attended two high schools, John McAllister High School and McLean Magnet High School. After that, I went to Duke University, where I was a music performance major. I played piano, working with 35 teachers, Ms. Veronica Downs Dorsey in the back. And then I went to law school, Pierce Law School from Loyola University, College of Law. So I'm here today to share with you what we do in First City Court. We do have, again, two clerks on the ballot, two different courts, Civil District Court and First City Court. And I'm here to share with you what we do in First City Court today. Thank you for
coming. Again, my name is Trey Causey, and I'm a senior at St. Augustine High School. So my question to you is, what are the goals and mission of your office?
So our office deals with civil lawsuits only. So, I mean, no criminal lawsuits, no traffic things, just civil lawsuits. What we try to do inside the office is work with the public because we have a unique office. We deal with attorneys and law firms who practice in our, what we call our civil docket, but then we deal with everyday people who come to court who deal with our evictions docket and our small claims. So those are suits for people who serve as their own attorney. So you can be your own attorney in those suits. In those two areas. So our goal in the office is to really connect with you all and to walk you through the process of filing a legal lawsuit or responding to a suit. So imagine if you're sued in court. Do you know what to do next? Do you know how to respond to that? And so if you come to our office, we actually will walk you through each step of that. That's part of our goal, to make sure that we serve the public through properly helping them to deal with the entire legal procedure. Sometimes it can be intimidating if you're called to court, if you have to go before a judge. And so we try to make sure that everyone feels comfortable, prepared, has the tools they need to be adequately defending themselves or presenting their case when they come before us.
Good morning. My name is Vaughn Thomas, Sam McDonald, 35 High School. My question is, what are the biggest changes you think we need to improve the clerk's office?
I think some of the biggest changes we need to improve the office deal with technology. So you may not remember this, some of the students here, but when I came into the office as the clerk of the court, they were still using an old time clock to keep time. In other words, people had to take a paper card every morning and punch it into the clock, and that clock would stamp things on it. Well, we switched that over as when I became the clerk to a cloud-based system. So you can do it from your mobile phone, from your smartphone, so you can do it from a tablet. I think one of the most important things to help us is going to be to really advance our technology in the office, so that we are keeping up with other courts around the state and around the country, and we're not falling behind as far as technology is concerned, but we're also embracing it because it helps us to keep the records more accurately, more efficiently. Right now, we have a lot of paper records. As you notice in your classes every day, you're relying more on computers, and people are investing more in computers and tablets for high school, for our schools. The same thing applies to the court system, to my office. We're investing more in modern technology to be able to have a better way of keeping our records, to be able to keep and help file the civil lawsuits that are filed in our court, and also have access to them so you can remotely access things. So right now, we have to come into the office to check something, whereas in the future, you can do that from your computer, from your home, from your office. So those are things we want to do to help improve the court.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Once again, I'm Sean Shelton from Warren Easting. I have more of a hypothetical question. In the situation where an owner is sued for a home rental, a short-term rental, then what are the procedures for that lawsuit, and who is the one at fault? Would it be the owner of the house, or would it be those who rented out the house?
That's an interesting question. If you are sued for, you said the owner of the house is sued, or who's sued?
Yeah, the owner of the house, but would the people who rented out the house be at fault?
So, probably not the people who rented the house. So right now, the short-term rental rules allow for so many days per year that someone can rent their home. If someone exceeds that, the procedure is not really, or the enforcement mechanism is not really a lawsuit, but deals with enforcement from the city, from City Hall, from the Mayor's administration. So in that case, it would be a suit. It would be some type of complaint filed against the person. They would be subject to fines or penalties that would be assessed from the city. And a lawsuit would not necessarily come from that. But there is something unique about First City Court that kind of applies here. There's a law that's carved out in the Code of Civil Procedure that allows a neighborhood association or government entity like the mayor of the city of New Orleans actually use First City Court exclusively to enforce things that deal with neighborhoods. So your neighborhood, for instance, has a ban on short-term rental, or a ban on some sort of activity involving the house. The city could enforce that only in First City Court. Now, it's never used, they never use it, but it's there, they have the option to use if they want to. But really, your question would probably deal more so with a complaint that's filed first and fines and penalties that will be assessed on that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you all for having me again. I want to thank the Lower Ninth Ward Voters Coalition for putting this forum together and all the students here from the schools who represented. I'm not sure if you're able to vote or not, but when you can vote, and if you can vote, vote in every election, no matter who you're voting for, whether it's me or somebody else, because if you don't have a vote, if you don't use your vote, you don't have a voice. So you can't determine what happens to your future, happens to your neighborhood, to your city, to your community, to your culture. So please make sure you become a voter, and what they call a chronic voter, who never misses an election. Even if you go away to college, still vote. Lastly, follow me on social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. It's just my full name, at Timothy David Rick. You can follow the campaign, see what we're doing, and hopefully one day when you are running for office or serving in office, you will have some experience doing that. All right? Thank you all for having me.
Good morning. I'm Omar Mason. I'm a candidate for Judge Orleans Parish Civil District Court, Division E. This is a parish-wide race, so everybody in Orleans Parish can vote in this particular election. I'm a lawyer with 19 years of courtroom experience. I was born here in New Orleans, right? Went to McDonough 35. I was served as a drum major at 35, went on to LSU and later graduated from Loyola Law. My wife and I, of almost 17 years, are raising our two daughters, ages 12 and 10, right here in New Orleans because we love our city and we want to see it succeed. Throughout my career, I've earned the respect and admiration of my peers and my community. I've earned a designation of super lawyer, a distinction that's given to only the top 5% of attorneys in the country. As judge, I will not just sit on the bench, but I will work every single day to stand up for our community. Thank you.